Welcome to this session co-hosted by Executive Education at the Said Business School, University of Oxford, and the Arizona State University Julie Ann Wrigley Global Futures Laboratory. I'm Dr. Bridget Custin. I'm an economic anthropologist and a research fellow at Oxford Said. This is the second event in a series, Intersectionality and Inclusion, convened by Dr. Zainab Kaba, Dr. Rohini Jalan, and myself. In our first discussion, Dr. Kaba, an education specialist at the School Center for Social Entrepreneurship, examined what it means to build transnational visibility and inclusion from the ground up through a case study of the global children's television series, Sesame Street. And we were examining how it approaches inclusion, focusing on the partnerships and process required to introduce a character with the skin condition of albinism. You can watch a recording of this episode via the school's YouTube coming soon. Now, this panel explores what a more inclusive vision for women's empowerment looks like, a vision that recognizes the importance of men as mentors, sponsors, and allies, and that acknowledges the specificity of different women's journeys and the kind of future that their companies are working to create. I'll turn it over now to my co-host, Amanda Ellis.
Thank you, Bridget. Aloha from Hawaii, everybody. I'm Amanda Ellis, and I lead global partnerships for the ASU Julie Ann Wrigley Global Futures Laboratory. I'm also the co-chair of a wonderful initiative called the We Empower United Nations Sustainable Development Goals Challenge, or We Empower UN SDG Challenge. ASU and Oxford Said Business School are the lead academic partners. We Empower is a global business competition across all 193 UN member countries. It promotes the inspiring work of women entrepreneurs who support the UN SDGs. Launched by the UN Secretary General and the Council of Women World Leaders at the General Assembly in New York in 2018, We Empower supports SDG 10, which was the focus of our first episode, in reducing inequality, and highlights the importance of SDG 5 to promote gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls. You are going to meet three amazing We Empower awardees today. But to introduce them, we have three short films.
Water, a commodity and basic human right that many of us take for granted. But each and every day in Africa, women spend over 200 million hours collectively looking for water.
The reality is that for 400 million Africans, safe water available in taps remains a very scarce resource. Piped water is an urban luxury.
Cristal's solution to the water crisis was simple yet effective. Using pre-drilled boreholes that are no longer functional, she engineered a water microgrid system called Enuma, designed specifically to serve people living in small rural communities.
Enuma feeds water from underground water sources, repairing the same boreholes that were broken before. But using solar technology, we pump the water, filter the water before distributing it to our choice community. But also, they now have the option to pull a pipeline in their home to have a simple access to a basic human right that we all here enjoy.
Thank you, Christelle. Such important work. And I know during COVID that you have pivoted to try to make sure that there's water in schools. So thank you for the wonderful work you're doing. And now we're going to see a film about the work of Leah Lizarondo of 412 Food Rescue.
Born and bred in the bustling city of Manila in the Philippines, Leah Lizarondo had always dreamed big.
412 Food Rescue is a direct response to the fact that we are wasting half our food supply. And when you look at the other side of that equation is that one in seven are hungry.
If this food was saved from going to landfill, it would be enough to feed everyone who was food insecure in the United States four times over.
What you do when you download our app is you basically sign on to be a driver, or what we call a food rescue hero. And what this means is, you know, Giant Eagle in Shadyside has food available today. Will you take it to this nonprofit that we've assigned it to?
Since launching in Pittsburgh in 2015, 412 Food Rescue now operates in another seven cities across North America. It has saved over 28 million pounds of food and redirected it to hundreds of NGOs. It has prevented 15 million pounds of carbon emissions and has inspired a community that cares about the planet and those in need.
We are all wired to do good, and I think we just all need an opportunity to believe in ourselves again.
So inspiring. I just love the fact that not only is Leah helping to feed the hungry, but she's also stopping methane gas in landfills and helping to solve climate change at the same time. Just wonderful innovation. Thank you, Leah. And now we have Alison Price from Soil Cyclers.
When I first started, I didn't own a pair of steel caps. I never imagined at, finishing school and going to uni that I would be running this kind of business, but I love it.
Meet Alison Price. She's an entrepreneur and an environmentalist in an industry not always known for its gentle carbon footprint. Inspired by a dream of making construction more sustainable, she set up Soil Cyclers in 2009 and has been pioneering large-scale soil recycling ever since.
I love that we can make a difference in construction. I feel like we go to sites and we're earning money by saving companies money and doing the right thing for the environment. I can't get that from any other job.
But managing a company in an industry where women make up only 3% of frontline roles is not easy. She runs a training program for women with no existing experience and teaches them the skills to be plant operators.
I know how daunting it was for me first starting out, and I'd love to make it a bit less daunting for some of the other women out there that have great skills that they could bring to the industry.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Alison. And having lived in Australia, I know just what a male-dominated industry you are in, and super inspiring to see what you're doing. We are going to go now to a big scene setter so that you as the audience can have an idea of the context that these incredible women are operating in. So we're going to be doing a couple of audience polls before we come back and talk to our entrepreneurs. So can we show the polls on the screen, please, for our audience to get a sense of the big picture? How many countries have achieved full gender equality? Three opportunities, 146. And just a reminder, there are 193 UN member countries, 67 or zero. So let's see what our audience is saying. Just a reminder, we're in 2020, which is, of course, the 25th anniversary of the Beijing Platform for Action. So we have an incredibly educated audience. So we can see the results now of the poll. Almost 89% of you got the answer right, yes. Sadly, we are in 2020, and as the World Economic Forum Global Gender Gap Report points out, not a single country has yet met gender equality. So let's look at how many countries have legislated for it. Achieving it is one thing, but is there a level playing field as far as legislation goes? So out of the 193 UN member countries, have 102, 44, or 8 legislated for laws that promote full gender equality and provide women the opportunity for a level playing field with their male counterparts? So let's see what our audience thinks about full gender equality under the law. Slightly less get it right this time, but still very well done. So 55% of our respondents are correct. Only 8 countries, according to the World Bank Women, Business and the Law study, even have legislation that provides full gender equality. So we can really see just how systemic this issue is, and yet women entrepreneurs are succeeding against the odds. Bridget, over to you.
Thanks, Amanda. They're succeeding the odds, and polls certainly demonstrate the scope of the problem in front of us and just how much technical, regulatory, legislative progress has to be made. But one of the things that we want to do with this session is, in spite of the mountain that still has to be climbed, is to start to parse the kind of concepts that we're working with. And what's interesting about women's empowerment as a phrase, as a concept, is that it does smooth over critical differences in how disempowerment and then empowerment are experienced. The phrase women's empowerment suggests that women are bound together in a shared struggle, and some may also viscerally believe that this is true, and their lived experience demonstrates that women are bound together in this shared struggle. But that is not historically how women's empowerment, globally speaking, has played out at all. In the US and the UK, for example, women's empowerment has historically meant the empowerment of white women at the expense of other women. A rising tide has not necessarily lifted all ships, even though that tide itself, is, as we've seen from the polls, is still a very minimally risen. Now, intersectionality is a concept that helps us to address these forms of exclusion by giving us a language to talk about the fact that different facets of one's identity shape how they encounter the world. But intersectionality is concrete. It's not a vague topic at all. It has its roots in law, actually. Legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw coined the term when describing how the law was not accounting for the unique dynamics of violence against Black women because of the way that race and gender entwined to shape and impact their experiences, especially when the law was involved. So let's widen the aperture now. The UN focuses on global women's empowerment through a number of channels, including the Sustainable Development Goals, the SDGs. Likewise, WE Empower, the entity that Amanda is involved with, serves to empower women globally. But let's start to parse where we can find some specificity here and understand that journeys are different, challenges are different. Now, our panelists have each received the We Empower Award for their region, so we're already recognizing some regional specificity there. But we do have some questions for our panelists now, and I'm thrilled that we get to hand the microphone over to them shortly so we can hear about their experiences and begin to understand how there are shared struggles, and yet journeys are different and challenges are different. And, you know, what we don't want to do is flatten out the specificity of that individual experience into saying every struggle is the same. So I think our first question, actually, Amanda, why don't you do the first question?
Thank you, Bridget, and so well said. You've set the scene beautifully. So let's start off by having each of our panelists discuss their own personal journeys, their inspiration behind their business, and We Empower. The We stands for Women Entrepreneurs. So love to hear from each of you, Christelle first, on what was the inspiration behind starting Water Access Rwanda, and what big challenge are you now grappling with?
Thank you, Amanda. I started Water Access Rwanda. At the time, I was very, very passionate about creating employment for other young people. But at the same time, I noticed that there was a huge crisis, the water crisis, which was a very simple matter of access to very simple technologies. So it required business models that would make this simple technology available to everybody. So there was no need to create new technology, innovate, just make sure that everybody has access to a simple need for life, which is water. As I worked on my business, I kind of struggled, or I was really trying to design for something that can deliver social value while also offering financial return, because I personally believe that the market has the biggest potential to sustain a solution and scale it very quickly. So we kind of wanted to go through this very tough line of creating social impact while generating profit and offering a human right, which is the access to water. So over time, we've thrown off of our table different unsustainable solutions and invited more sustainable models. And this required kind of saying no to what was the status quo. For me, that was saying no to hand pumps and saying yes to water mini-grids, piped water inside everyone's home. And that's what we've been doing now at Water Access Rwanda, saving women time, because when we provide unsustainable water solutions in the rural areas, we're condemning women to keep on walking outside of their homes for hours every day to access a basic need of life, one they will need to access. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christelle. And I want everybody to know that you're in your mid-20s too. So incredible. Here you are as a water engineer, and you've employed over 60 disadvantaged youth in Rwanda. And at the same time, you're helping provide access to so many women and children. So thank you for the great work. And now we're going to go across the other side of the globe, from Rwanda to Australia. So Alison, tell us a little bit about the inspiration behind your business and the challenge that you might be grappling with right now.
Sure, Amanda. I think, like many women who enter a very male-dominated industry, I did it accidentally. So there was nothing that inspired me to enter the construction industry. When I started this job, I was actually trying to give my very recent boyfriend at the time, he's now my husband, a job and get him off my couch, because I realized he had some quite specialized skills. So now that I'm here and I've realized how much I love doing what I do, I guess the thing I continue to grapple with our business is we're very innovative, and we have very much changed the way the industry operates. And we've done that fairly successfully in the construction industry. And probably my next stage to tackle is the mining industry. And when you're doing something different, it's always a challenge to get those early adopters to give it a go. But I think when you manage to juggle the environment and cost savings at the same time, it's a win-win for everyone involved, so that definitely helps.
Wonderful, thank you. And so many small businesses are family businesses too, so love the fact that you got your boyfriend off the couch and you now have such a thriving business. Leah, love to hear your story.
Yeah, so the inspiration for what we do is actually coming from a big sense of discomfort. And that's, you know, with the knowledge that, you know, 40% of our food goes to waste. And on the other side of that, we know that so many people are food insecure. And, you know, this number is doubled in this pandemic. So in the face of that knowledge that, you know, we're throwing away half our food supply when so many on the other side need it, you begin to question why that is happening and where is it? Where's that disconnect? And, you know, realizing that it's purely, you know, a distribution problem. So a big part of food insecurity is not about producing more food, because we are throwing away half of it. It's all about making sure that it's going to the right places. It's going to where people need it. And so knowing that, and knowing the fact that everyone is uncomfortable with food waste, we all have an idea that we're wasting food. We just didn't know it was to this extent. You know, how can we solve this problem? No one wanted to pay for transporting surplus food from one location to an NGO. And so we had to do it for free. But then how could we do that? How could we scale something like that? How could we build a transport network without any money? And basically a model that exists already, you know, to Christelle's point, it's not new to technology. Some of the biggest, you know, car companies where we, you know, go to the airport and call a cab, you know, Uber and Lyft, they're the largest transport companies without owning a single cab. And so we asked ourselves, how can we do the same thing? How can we create the largest food transport network without owning a single vehicle, without having a warehouse? And, you know, we now order food through delivery, and it's such a common thing, especially in this pandemic. And we do the same thing, except that it's surplus food that, you know, no one else values really, but someone really can use. This is perfectly good food. And through using that same model that commercial delivery services use, single cause, you know, redirecting 35 million pounds of food over 160,000 trips is, you know, that's extremely satisfying. And so it was, the inspiration was seeing a disconnect and seeing possibilities. And I think once you see possibilities, you really can't unsee them.
Awesome example of systems thinking and innovation. It's just such a great model. And as you say, the fact that so many people are food insecure, and that if the food goes to landfill, it creates methane and helps more problems with create more problems with greenhouse gases. So a real win-win. Thank you so much.
So women's empowerment means the freedom for women to not be boxed in by assumptions about how women act, what we're like. It seems like an obvious point to say that we're all different. And yet women's empowerment, women's traits, our leadership styles are often talked about in a really unifying way. We're more empathetic, we're better listeners. And again, I'm wondering if this kind of way of talking about women leaders actually flattens out the complexity that is possible. and you know, if we recognize the complexity, what then becomes possible? Now, you're all leaders in male-dominated fields, a tech startup for Leia, a waste management for Allison, engineering for Christelle, and this does make you visible. How have you each had to navigate your male-dominated industries in your rise to becoming an entrepreneur CEO? And as our speakers get ready to answer that question, I also want to remind everyone watching to submit some questions in the Q&A. You can start submitting those questions now, and we'll have time to ask our speakers your questions. So, journey in your male-dominated industry. Let's hear about the different challenges and the different pathways that were taken. Christelle, how about me?
Right.
Actually, why don't we... this is the limitation of the online format. None of us want to interrupt each other. Let's just keep to the same order. Why don't we have Christelle and then Allison and then Leia?
Awesome. For me, being in a male-dominated field, I started feeling it in my engineering classes. We were a class of 42 to begin with, and we were only 4 female. By second year, the other 2 female engineering students had dropped out. So it was only 2 of us, and, you know, we kind of stuck together until graduation. Now, coming to entrepreneurship, first of all, you notice there is a lot of rooms and lots of meetings that happen where you're not involved. And once you do get involved, it's awkward for everybody. So there is almost that feeling. I'm a really good person at sensing people, and I've always felt whenever I get into these moments that I have to show everybody, like, you know, I'm a boys' girl. You know, I can be manly, or I can, you know, support their jokes or whatever they used to say without women in the room. And for me, that's kind of the challenge, because especially being in Rwanda, we have this feeling that women have gained so much. But then you discover there's these pockets where women are not participating at all, and you're always the pioneer in that room. So there is a lot of challenge. You find a lot of misconceptions and myths about women. And sometimes these misconceptions and myths are not that those things are not true, but it's how they're perceived as limiting factors to your ability. One thing I loved listening to the other people speak about, the other ladies speak about their inspiration, is the ability that we women have to see, to look at the research, look at the numbers, and not just leave it at that, but see a problem and respond with empathy, with the way, like, what do I have that can provide for this situation? And whenever I've seen women lead, they lead with solutions, they lead with empathy, and that means usually bringing so many people together. And that's why women start a lot of social enterprises. So I've found in my journey, especially in entrepreneurship, I've had to come to reality with the fact that there is a lot I'm not offered that I have to fight for. There is a lot of rooms I'm not into, but at the same time, acknowledging that there are people willing to see the different biases that are out there on women and challenge it with action. People who have pulled my hands and introduced me to those rooms that people didn't think I belonged to, people who have introduced me to funding opportunities. We empower programs that really empower women, not that we're not able to do what we do, but we need that access, we need that exposure. And that's why We Empower was so amazing, building us up and providing us the contacts that we need. So I would say my journey in an engineering field, in entrepreneurship, there is a lot of doubt, there is a lot of questioning. Most people don't see a female leader as one that can be technologically savvy. They often assume my skill set is elsewhere. So I get often a question, engineering and water, what's the relationship? And I'm like, what's not the relationship? And I've watched other people who innovate in this sector, and they don't get asked the same question. So it's kind of realizing how the world treats you differently as a woman in a specific sector compared to how they treat men in the same sector doing almost the same work you are doing. So there is that complexity that's added into being a leader, offering solutions, yet meeting a lot of doubt and questioning and non-access. So there is a lot of access that you don't even know you need. There's a lot of bias you face that you don't even realize you're facing until it's pointed out. Then you see it as a woman. But also as a woman, we know how to fight. We know how to keep it going and to be stubborn on our vision and mission. And for me, that's been a great strength to draw from, especially as I face all these obstacles that are literally uncalled for.
You know, Crystal, what's so interesting about what you said is that I think to someone watching this broadcast from Western Europe, they might think, okay, the interesting story here is that she is a female entrepreneur in Rwanda. Her Rwandan identity is what's most important. Whereas most of what you said in your comments was about you identifying as an engineer, first and foremost. You started with engineering class. You then talked about how it's your skill set that you want to be recognized first and foremost. And that's exactly the point of this session, really, is to point out that rather than superimposing identities onto people or deciding this is what is interesting about them, let's actually pause and hear how people self-identify and what they lead with. Because what I'm hearing from you is, I'm Crystal, first and foremost, speak to me as an engineer.
And an entrepreneur, Allison. Yeah, exactly.
And an entrepreneur, exactly. Allison, let's hear about your journey.
Sure. I sat there almost nodding along as Crystal talked, that the story is actually incredibly similar, despite me living in a country that probably gives women a lot more opportunities than what Crystal's country does. So for me, when I started my journey in this industry, I was very young, so I wouldn't exactly call myself much of a leader at that time. I didn't have the experience, I didn't have the skills, and like many women, I started out thinking that I had to fit in with the blokes and thinking that I had to be quite masculine and be the same as them. And what I've realized over the years is that it's very important to keep those differences, to keep that femininity and to keep the things that make me think differently, because they're the things that are my strengths in this industry. I've had a lot of experience of sitting in rooms and feeling like you have to enjoy the jokes that maybe make you feel a little bit uncomfortable. For me, I think what I can add to those rooms is I change the conversation. A lot of those men might not feel like they're comfortable swearing in front of a woman. And so a lot of those quite aggressive confrontational conversations become very collaborative conversations. And suddenly you can actually have a negotiation where no one's swearing at each other or yelling at each other. Being a female in the room in a very male-dominated industry, it breaks the mold and it breaks the traditional way we've done things. And I think it's only a good thing for our industry. I'll pass over to Leah.
You know what, Leah, before we get to you, I just want to ask one follow-up question, which is, you are the director of a workforce that's almost entirely male. And how did that work as an entrepreneur CEO? Did you just, give yourself the title straight away? What did it take in order for you to even, position yourself as a leader for your workforce?
Sure. I actually started out calling myself the office manager. I think a lot of my clients, and we started with some very big tier one construction industry clients, if they'd known I was the director at the time, I didn't have the skills or the experience to them to be running a business in the construction industry. they would never, ever have worked with us. So I was the office manager, and people told me a lot of things when I was the office manager. It was quite an interesting perspective to run your own business and call yourself the office manager. A few years ago, I gave myself a promotion to operations manager. And then a couple of years after that, I finally announced that I was the managing director. And I had a lot of people congratulate me. Because a lot of people didn't even realize that it was my business. And, one of the most common questions I get asked is it your dad's business? And often those people will follow up with, is it your husband's business? They don't really think about a female entrepreneur starting a business in such a male-dominated industry. But there's a lot of research about female entrepreneurs in male-dominated industries actually tending to employ more people as a business. So for me as a manager, managing a very male-dominated workforce, and I've worked very hard within my business to change that and to make us quite a diverse workforce, and I think I've been quite successful at that. We do have quite a number of female operators, frontline workers, and we've got quite a good gender balance within our team now. But it wasn't always like that, and it was very challenging, and I had to change my management style to suit managing men. You know, when you're in your mid-20s and you're managing men who are twice your age, that's very challenging as a leader, let alone a female leader in a very male-dominated industry, definitely.
Great. Leah, let's hear about your experience in the world of tech startups.
Yeah. So I think one of the, the first, expression or, understanding that this is going to be different was all the way back in the beginning. You know, when you're starting a tech startup and then you are confronted with a statistic that, less than 5% of venture capital goes to female founders, and even less so for non-white female funders, it goes down to 2%. You know, you start an organization and you already have a 98% handicap. And so one of my biggest fears was, this will die before it's even proven. And so I have to be really creative, because I completely believe this was going to work, that we can create the same transport network as Uber and Lyft, but with a really core differentiator in terms of assumption, is that people are going to do this for free. They are going to volunteer, and that we can drive volunteers to perform, in parity or even better than commercial delivery services. And so we wanted to start an organization that, will have a chance. And so we said, okay, what will have a chance? The clear path, the path to revenue wasn't clear. So we can't promise any venture capitalist the 10x return that they're looking for. But there was a clear path to social good. So we can promise the philanthropic community, the drastic disruptive change that they are looking for. And so that's why this organization was started as an NGO, because we needed $10 million that no VC was going to give us. And we did it. I have so many friends who have technology startups. And when I tell them how much money we've raised, they're eking out $1 million when, because there is such a clear social good, the philanthropic community has taken that risk and said, yes, we'll invest in this technology. And now this technology mobilizes the largest volunteer food transport network. And it operates at a 1% cancellation rate, whereas, commercial delivery services are closer to 5 to 10%. So, and we get to a point now, 6 years later, where we can actually take the technology out of the operating organization and begin the transition to a social enterprise, because now there is a clear path to revenue as the technology has proven itself and is now being licensed in 9 other cities. So it's such an interesting decision to make in the beginning, where it's a non-traditional pathway, but you want something to survive. And so you take a path that you never thought you would take. So the second thing that, is such, a big differentiate, like a really clear experience for me was
reading how I read somewhere where, you know, in job applications, you know, women will take all of the requirements. And if they don't, they don't, you know, cover one, they wouldn't apply to the job. And so I'm going to talk about the We Empower Challenge. And, you know, I saw this challenge and then I said, okay, this is, we are so ripe for this. You know, we deserve this recognition. We deserve this opportunity. We are not a for-profit. But then I remembered, and I wasn't going to apply. And then I remembered this thing I read about women in job interviews and applying to jobs. And men, you know, they see two things that they are qualified for and they will apply to the job. And so I said, you know, I will act like a man. And even though I don't qualify for this one clear thing, I'm still going to apply. And I remember creating my video the night before because I hemmed and I hawed and I said, I don't qualify, but then I'm going to do it anyway. And lo and behold, you know, because I did that, because I didn't stop at that one thing, you know, we were able to receive the award and actually change the way We Empower operates because we did that. And so, you know, I think making these decisions as a woman, it was extremely important. They were not easy decisions. But now, you know, many years later have, you know, allowed us to, you know, not only prove ourselves, but actually change the way people think about hunger. And that decision was, and both those decisions were infinitely worth it.
Fantastic.
Maya, I'm still stuck. Sorry, Amanda.
So excited to jump in here because as a judge of We Empower, I can so endorse what Leia has just said. We really need to be thinking outside the box. And as judges, we looked at it and we said, well, she's not actually a for-profit entrepreneur, but she ticks all the other boxes. She has over 100,000 a year in revenues. And Leia's right. She changed our thinking. We realized that we had been in old models as well. And that's the beauty of this kind of competition. It really helps people find innovative solutions to our planet's big problems. And thinking about the comment that Allison and Christelle both made about diversity, there's a question in the chat from Aylin Edhouse who says, is there research or data about what happens when companies fail to retain or promote women? So we know that there is a 6% higher return on investment when women have a meaningful seat at the table. And so you're looking not only at three very successful women entrepreneurs in non-traditional areas, but in fact, they exemplify this notion of what is now called the diversity dividend. So thank you, Aylin, for that excellent question. And this is a wonderful segue into the fact that all of you run businesses which need to be able to maintain themselves, but you also have environmental and social missions. So it's a true triple bottom line. You're looking at people and planet as well as profit. And digging in just a little bit deeper on the amazing responses that you've given about identity. So thinking about your gender identity, but not limiting to that, how is there a connect to the social and environmental missions of your companies? And we'll start again with Christelle.
Yeah, thank you, Amanda. This is super inspirational. I'm nodding off at everybody else. Yeah, for me, when I started the company and the reason I run it every day, it's really to meet these social needs. I think the revenue piece and the profit piece should be a natural outcome of us having met our goals. So here, let me actually give a few examples outside of my business, but, Professor Mark Kremer, Harvard, says you can't be a successful business in a failed society. So the way I see my work with water is you have one side of the world that consumes over 300 liters per person per day. And then you come to Rwanda and people are consuming only 3 liters per person per day. Something is wrong. And the WHO says a person needs 50 to 100 liters per day. So that means although one side of the world is over consuming, something is happening that's preventing people in Rwanda and the rest of Africa to just meet their basic need for water at 50 liters per day. So what is that? Why is there something of a missing market? And so once you look at the issue, you find that there is a lack of entrepreneurs offering them the solutions and driving up their market demand. So what we see when we started doing the public water points, people would drive up their demand for water, but they would still reach a ceiling at around 10 to 15 liters per person per day. Once they have a piped connection in their home, they go to 56 liters per person per day. So I know in the US or London, the conversation is all about reducing your water usage, but right now in sub-Saharan Africa, it's quite different. We want to make sure people are using safe water for all their basic needs. So once they have a piped access to water at home, they can actually reach the WHO recommended standard of 50 liters minimum per person per day. Now, that's the social impact met. But at the same time, what it means is we went into a market where people were only going to buy 3 liters per day, created a new market where people are buying 56 liters per day. So it makes it tough to pitch to investors because you're like, well, the market size, what's the market size? 3 liters per person per day. But once we've intervened, it's going to go to 56 liters. So most for-profit investors are not that patient. They don't want to participate in the market building. They just want to address an existing market. So for me, a lot of the work we do, it seems like we're going to lose money. But when you actually see the results, we're creating the market that's going to feed our business. So we see ourselves as kind of a midway. We get all this capital that could have even come through nonprofit sources or governments can do this, but we get it from private investors, invest in this infrastructure. So it's the infrastructure itself will always be there protected, protecting the investment of those who invested. But after 1 year, you have a whole new market to service for generations. And I like to say that once a person has a piped water connection, their children can inherit the home and the water, and it goes on for generations. So you access, you create for yourself a market that's going to sustain the company for generations to come. And that for me is invaluable because by helping somebody, we're meeting the profit demands for running a business. So there definitely must be revenue and profit for the idea to run. Again, my belief in market being able to drive solutions. But once we prove that building a market is a worthy cause, through what we're doing in water, we will see even more social entrepreneurs take more patient approaches to their enterprises, giving it 1 year, 5 years, or 10 years, because some markets are much tougher, to really create solutions for the bottom of the pyramid. Right now, everybody is designing for the half billion people at the top of the pyramid. So designing for the bottom of the pyramid requires that level of patience to build the market out of a place where people don't usually see a market.
Would you like me to step in and keep going? So I'll answer the question as well. And I think that for me, I realized we thought quite differently, or I thought quite differently as a business owner. And when I was approaching these jobs, because I didn't have the background in the industry, I was able to see different and better ways to do things. And when you can see different and better ways to do things, and I do think a lot of that has come from me being an outsider to the industry and having that desire to change the industry, but also not having those set ways of the way the industry has always done things. You know, previously we always dug holes in the ground and we found material that wasn't suitable. We would truck it away to landfill and buy new material. And so when you're a female entrepreneur and you come from outside the industry, it definitely gives you the ability to see things differently. What about you, Leah?
I definitely agree. I think that, like Allison, coming into So the social aspect of what we do is, you know, immediate effect is hunger alleviation, and the compounding effects, you know, affect climate change. But so in hunger alleviation, you know, there's just been one way we've tackled hunger for the last 50, 75 years. It has never changed. And I remember when we first thought of this idea, I actually didn't want to do it. So I brought the idea upon it to the food banking network. And I said, you know, you guys are doing such a great job doing this. And, you know, but there's this one huge opportunity that I think will really make a difference and allow you to reach people that are very hard to reach. And we've seen that even more so in this pandemic as people get homebound. And, you know, like Allison, the response was, oh, we don't do it that way. And I know that, but I'm trying to tell you that there's a fantastic new thing that you can do, and I'm willing to help you get it off the ground. And the answer was no. And it's at that point, that's when, you know, we decided, okay, we're going to do it. And so looking and seeing a solution that was extremely clear to you, you know, but there's so much baggage from, you know, what is the status quo? And women, because they often are not at the table, you know, their mere presence is questioning a status quo, you know, brings a completely different perspective sometimes that, you know, is sorely needed in industries that haven't changed for many years. And I think the core premise of what we do, because it does, you know, entail believing in people, it does entail on, you know, resting our, you know, labor force on, you know, our own propensity to actually be there for each other. That is, you know, I'm sorry, but that's like, you know, an empathetic female trait, which is, again, not generalized, but it's really actually been very motherly, and I am a mother. And so bringing those perspectives to the table, you know, if we don't foster diversity, we might miss our biggest chances for innovation.
It's such an incredible point. Thank you. Like that's the point of this. That's the point of these conversations. And we're so honored that you were able, all three of you were able to join us. And the questions that we're getting for everyone listening and are absolutely amazing and show a real depth of interest in the topic and span everything from a very necessary corrective pointing out that Rwanda is far ahead of many Western nations in terms of gender equity to questions around practical steps forward. And I'm going to take one question from the audience right now, keeping an eye on the time. For the men who have good intentions and want to empower the women they work with, but perhaps aren't sure what this practically entails, what would you tell them? How do you experience your gender at work? We've already covered that. What do you have to navigate? So what would be some practical things that you would want the men listening in to know about what empowerment actually means in terms of their daily behaviors, activities? Anyone who wants to jump in and take this.
You want to go the opposite. We can go the opposite way. So one of the best, you know, most helpful thing men can do is that whenever they are in a meeting with a woman is to try very, very hard to leave their assumptions, you know, at the door. I've been in many meetings where I would go with our head of engineering, who is this fantastic, you know, guy. And, you know, there are some, you know, tables where I'm at where the questions would be always directed at him. And I remember this one meeting where I actually went into this big dream state where I said, well, I can just coach him. And then he can say the things I want to say. And then there won't be a film with what he's saying, because everything I say goes through this film of me being a woman and a minority. But he, you know, can just say things and it's just what he's saying. And so I have toyed with this fact that maybe we'll just do this. I'll give him a script. I'll give him a Q&A. I'll coach him and he will say everything. And then maybe I'll get more than what I asked for. Of course, I didn't do that. But leaving your assumptions at the door is one of the biggest ones. And then I have to say that ever since from the beginning of my career started at Colgate Palmolive. I was in product management. All of my bosses were male, and all of them were the most all except one, and all of them were the most encouraging individuals that I could have ever hoped for. And to this day, they're my friends. I consider them my cheerleaders, my mentors. And even as we started this organization, the biggest funder that we have is a man. And those things, you know, these men have been able to overcome whatever it is, whatever biases may exist, and just, you know, saw me for what I can bring to the table without putting a gender lens to it.
Great answer, Leah. I find myself sitting here just nodding away. The second thing I would say on that front is don't get hung up on whether you need to use the pink paper or the green paper for the invitations to the gender diversity event. A lot of men, I think, are really uncomfortable around this topic, and they want to help, but they don't know how. So I would say to all of the men in the room with me, don't worry about that kind of thing. Have the conversation. Most women are very approachable, especially women in male-dominated industries. For me, any man that is trying to do the right thing is doing the right thing as far as I'm concerned. I love seeing men who have teams and doing their very best to get gender balance within those teams, because that's one small step to a future where potentially we're not even having this conversation anymore. So the men in the room, in these very male-dominated industries, we absolutely need you. You're an essential part of this. But also, I want to make sure that when women are in the industry, that it's a better place for the women and the men that work in the industry, that it changes the culture for everyone for the better, not just for the women in the room. What about you, Christelle?
Christelle, can you hear us?
Right, let me jump in. Sorry, yes. I thought Alison was still going. I think my advice to men in the room right now is to really, really look hard, because there is a bias and there is a problem, but I think they're not conditioned to see it the same way as we women are, because we're just getting in the room. So what may look normal to them right now is not the normal that should be there. So for me, really, I want the men to always look, because women get really credit for what they came up with. And this is something that can easily happen when a female and a male colleague are working together. You often find what Leah touched on, that things sound better when the man says it. And sometimes, you know, there is all this phenomenon we have about mansplaining, where a man kind of repeats what you just said, but somehow because they say it, it sounds better and more people listen. This is something that happens every day, everywhere. And it annoys me as a woman, but it also shows the power that men have to still do that, but offer credit where credit is due. Because in this world, like, I've had many men really take me by the hand and put me in places that they knew I belonged in those places, but nobody had opened the door for me yet. They knew they had that access that I didn't have, and they realized I needed to have that access. So as men, you really need to look and question. I was participating recently to a pitching company. You know, all these startups came over asking for money, and much as they touched on, of course, the female startups were asking for way lower than I have to coach myself to stop doing. But at the same time, I saw all these male-founded companies, team slide after team slide, no female on their management or senior management team. So it made me, like, for me, I was screaming out of my whole male investor panel pointed it out. For me, I was like, there is no female on your team. There is no female on your team. It was spinning in my head, realized. So for me, men in the room, look at those things. We women, this is what discourages us. This belongs in the room, that we have no place in this world. And imagine, on top of all the challenges we have to face as entrepreneurs, we add in challenges because of who we are. That almost impairment that Leah talked about of us being female. So use your power correctly to give credit where credit is due, to provide access to people who need the access, who should be in the rooms you are in, and make sure you really see the bias, because the bias is there. We're not making it up. It's there, so see it and move to correct it.
Brilliant. And you've all answered a number of other questions in the chat about the role men can play. There's one other from Ruth Espinola Soriano Domelo, who is a professor at PUC Rio. And she talks about the importance of government frameworks for the bigger picture. So I wanted to direct you all to the resource pages. We were going to show a short video on that, but we are running out of time given the brilliant women we have with us. So direct you to the resource page to view those videos. And finally, to also just remind everybody of some of the research that shows that given there are so many barriers for women entrepreneurs, that learning in an all-women environment can also really make a difference. So I now have a wonderful task that I am thrilled to be able to undertake. So thank you, Oxford Saeed, for giving me the honor of making some very special announcements now. So as lead academic partners for We Empower, Oxford and ASU share the goal of enabling women to access high-quality development experiences at critical points within their careers. So first of all, to Christelle and to Allison, in recognition for all that you have achieved as We Empower regional awardees for Asia Pacific and Africa, respectively, it is our greatest pleasure to award you both a place at Oxford Saeed's new online Women's Leadership Development Program. And this course provides the opportunity to better understand your unique leadership attributes, to enrich your own styles so you can better influence, negotiate, and navigate conflict. And I'm delighted to collaborate as one of the program speakers and can personally attest to the incredible impact on previous participants. So congratulations, Allison and Christelle. We know you are going to love this course. And now, Leah, to you as the overall winner of We Empower 2019 Global Pitch Competition, Oxford Saeed, as a committed academic partner to ASU and to We Empower, is delighted to award you with a place on the Women Transforming Leadership Program. This is an in-person flagship which will give you access to a thriving community of women leaders all around the globe who become peer mentors and coaches and often personal friends too throughout their careers. Congratulations. So, and for my part, special thanks to Oxford Saeed, Dean Peter Tofano, and to Director of Executive Education, Caroline Williams, for tremendous support to the We Empower UN SDG Challenge. We could not dream of better partners. So big clap to Christelle, to Allison, and to Leah. Congratulations, and over to you, Bridget.
Well, that's a wonderful closing note. If one thing shines through this session, it's that there aren't shortcuts to building empathy and understanding. It takes time to pause and listen to each person's journey and their challenges and how they're overcoming them and what they're building and what their motivating passions are. And there's something powerful about just taking the time to, you know, pause and actually listen. On that note, thank you so much to Leah, to Allison, to Christelle for sharing what you've built. It's absolutely amazing. And thank you so much to Allison for what you're doing with We Empower and your advocacy for women's empowerment And this has been a very rich discussion on a complicated topic with lots of global resonances. And we all encourage everyone to watch what we're doing for the next session for the Intersectionality and Inclusion series. We have another session yet to come, and more information about that will be coming soon on the events page for Oxford Said. So thanks again to all of our presenters, to everyone listening in, and we hope to see you again.